you're doing now. And God, we thank you for what you are going to do. We give it all to you right now, God, and we just say thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for this another day that you have allowed us to be in the number one more time. And we thank you most of all for loving us so much that you gave your son Jesus to die on the cross, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we say thank you for looking beyond our faults and seeing our needs. And we pray, God, that you would save every sinner everywhere. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in this morning. Thank you, Lord, for opening up the lines and allowing this broadcast to go forth in Jesus' name. We give you praise and glory this morning. We thank God for the woman of God. We thank God for being God, and we just lift him up today. Prayer changes things, and we are thankful today to be coming to you live at 5 this morning on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning on the internet around the world at www.foxy97.com. And you can also join us on the conference call with these awesome men and women of God as they are coming in this morning. No interruptions. We're all on the line. I can see everybody this morning. You can join all of us this morning at 267-807-9611. Access code 266-590. This is going to be a powerful devotion this morning. We have an awesome, powerful man of God that is going to share with us. I've already been blessed as we did our sound check this morning, and I know you will be tremendously blessed on today. Not just happy, but spiritually fully satisfied, spiritually prosperous, to be approved by God, as we have been studying in the Beatitudes, the blessings, the attitudes, to be about the attitudes of the kingdom. I'm going to ask Pastor Sellers to come on this morning. Thank you, Pastor Wright. But I just want Pastor Sellers once again to just to open us up and just with a quick word of prayer, Pastor Sellers, before opening prayer. That was intercessory prayer. We're getting ready to go in. But Pastor Sellers, just a quick word of opening prayer before we bring
man, your morning
our
is
guest
now on
on
the air.
Hallelujah. Before we bring our
Glory
guest on. Hallelujah.
Glory to your holy name. Father, we just honor you this morning. We worship you. We adore you, Father. We glorify your name. We lift up your name to the highest, Father God. Father God, in your name, Heavenly Father God, your name is a strong tower. And the righteous run unto you on a safe and find safe, dear Lord God. Truly, you are protected and our protection, Father God. Truly, Lord God, our hope, our confidence, Lord God. Everything we depend on, Lord God, is within you. So grateful, Lord God, for another day that you allowed us, Lord God, to come together, Lord God, to agree as intention, Father God. We are so grateful, Heavenly Father God, for what you're doing in our lives and what you're about to do, Father. I ask that you bless this radio station this morning, Lord God. Bless this command your morning. Bless every listener, Father God, especially our speaker, Father God, today, Lord God. I ask that you move on our behalf, Father God. We need a word from you, Father God. So we thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Just wanted to hear his voice this morning as my pastor, leader, my husband this morning. I also want to give honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to all those that are on the call this morning, to Mr. Warren Lee at WHLJ and all of his affiliates. I want to give honor to our apostle, Apostle Terry Weems, and his wife, Pastor Sade Weems, because it is through him and his wife, well, that we are able to connect to the man of God that is going to minister today. It's not the first time that we didn't meet him at the wedding. That wasn't the first meeting. We met him in Waycross as one of our brothers was being affirmed as an apostle. We met him in Waycross, but we got a chance to sit around the table at our apostle's wedding on last year. In the middle of COVID-19, we're at the wedding reception, and we're seated at the table, and Pastor Sells and I are looking. And I'm thinking to my mind, okay, well, the chairs are going to be spread out. Well, that was not the case, but when Apostle Brown, Aditi Brown sat down, I told my husband, listen, Apostle's sitting here, we're going to be just fine. Apostle Ruth Mobley sat down. I said, uh-oh, more fire, we're going to be just fine. And then others sat down, and then here comes this man of God and his beautiful wife sitting at the table. And I'm like, we going to be just fine with all this power at one table, all this fire at one table. We're going to be just fine. But today we have a awesome man of God, a profound teacher, a profound educator in the Word of God, a profound orator of the Word, Bishop Anthony Hatcher, Ph.D., Bishop Anthony J. Hatcher, overseer and apostle of Faith Life Outreach Christian Cathedral, formerly known as World of Faith Outreach Christian Center, and the Faith Life Covenant Ministries International. He partners in ministry with his wife, Pastor Charlene Hatcher. Headquarters is in Rockledge, Florida. It was an honor to sit at the table with this man of God and his wife and so many others at that wedding. And I'm thankful today. It's an honor just to have him on Command Your Morning today. He is known as a premier leader in establishing churches by utilizing the powerful medium of apostolic authority. He is a multifaceted leader, reaching all aspects of the community. His multi-gifts have caused him to be sought after by diverse leaders from all different ethnic backgrounds to address religious, business, political, civic, and educational issues. That entails what it means to live as a citizen of the kingdom. Bishop Hatcher has degrees in biblical studies, Christian counseling, Christian education, and a doctorate of divinity. He is listed in the biographical publication of Who's Who in American universities and of colleges. He was also recognized by First Lady Nancy Reagan, the wife of former President of the United States Ronald Reagan, for the Great American Family of the Year Award for displaying committed family values. Bishop Hatcher has been recognized by three of their local cities for his and the ministry's efforts in the community with the Key to the City of Rockledge, and September 25th is recognized as Bishop Anthony Hatcher and the World of Faith Outreach Christian Center Day. To God be the glory. Most recently, Bishop Hatcher received his Ph.D. in religious studies from Tabernacle Bible College. Thereafter, Bishop was named president of Faith Life Christian University. Bishop has extended the reach of the Faith Life Outreach Christian Cathedral. In his recent travel, he has had the privilege to speak with and minister to leaders, third world nations, namely Jamaica. He is committed to preaching and teaching a relevant word based on biblical principles. Let me say that again, because we're going to talk about that. He is committed to preaching and teaching a relevant word based on biblical principles in the most precise and profound form of sound doctrine. And I'm going to have him tell you why that is important to him, and also why that should be important to us. It's important to Command Your Morning. It's important to Upper Room. It's important to, it should be important to every leader to make sure that they are committed to preaching and teaching a relevant word based on the principles that are in the Word of God. So this morning I'm going to bring forth Bishop Anthony Hatcher all the way from Rockledge, Florida. I certainly do give honor to his wife this morning and thank God for the opportunity to have you join us on Command Your Morning. It is an honor, sir. Good morning once again. Hallelujah.
Good morning, and grace and peace be multiplied to all of you. And I pray today that God is going to give you everything that pertains to life and godliness.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that apostolic greeting this morning. We just give you praise, give God praise this morning. God praise this morning for what is going to be said this morning, because we have been ministering from Matthew chapter 5, and we've been talking about where Jesus comes in and announces the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So we've been talking about kingdom principles, and I'm thankful today, as I taught you earlier this morning, that you already are prepared, ready to share with us what that entails with the time that we have. Now, one thing that I noticed in your bio, and I'm excited this morning, it says that you are a multifaceted leader, reaching all aspects of the community. I believe, it's important for us, as with Jesus was about community, he was about ministering and teaching to people of all walks of life, not leaving anybody out. He came so that all of us could be saved and delivered, and came to reconcile us back to God. Why is it important today for leaders to come outside and be to be multifaceted, as you say in your bio, and to be involved in not just the four walls of the church and what is going on inside the ministries, but to be involved in every aspect of community? Why is that important?
Well, it is important because God is raising us up. You know, it's a New Testament principle. You look in Revelations 1 and 6, Jesus, gives us an end-time principle that says that he's made us kings and priests. To him be glory, dominion, and honor forever and ever. And so there's a marriage going on in the body of Christ between ministry and marketplace and all different types of applications where it comes from different structures and systems. And God is opening up us to come into all different types of streams so that we can be a light many times, shining in dark places. And so, God, if you look at some of the callings of some of our patriots, many of them were able to speak to kings and people of great positions, people that was creative. And, you know, one of the applications, it tells us that Daniel was 10 times greater than musicians and those that operated in the world system. And sometimes the world system needs a spiritual eye or spiritual insight or spiritual declaration made over them to let them know that the kingdom of God is coming to bring power and dominion for the people of God to walk in a place in God that they've never been. And I believe God is calling us to be an answer. No matter where he sent us, if he's sending us into the business community, he's sending us to educational community, wherever God's voice needs to be heard, I believe that he's equipping us with apostolic and prophetic influences to cause an impact in those particular stratas or those particular structures so that God can be glorified.
I like that you said that he is sending us no matter where to be the answer, no matter what
yes.
system and no matter where we are. And I just want to encourage the people this morning with the word, you are the answer. And so many times people, we feel that if we are not, that we're only doing ministry. I don't want to do ministry. I don't want to work anymore. I don't want to work in a secular world. But I want to speak to that because when we are there as believers, the kingdom is there. We are there as citizens of the kingdom of heaven, and we can do ministry anywhere. And
yes.
sometimes we feel we have to quit our jobs, and if God tells us to do that, that's one thing. But we don't have to quit our job in the corporate world to do ministry. Can you speak to that this morning and encourage those who feel that I'm not in the right place and I feel that I can't do ministry where I am? Tell us about that and how you did that.
As I alluded to first, in Revelations 1 and 6, it talks about he's made us kings and priests in his kingdom. To him be glory and dominion forever. And it talks about, and if you look at an aspect of what God is talking about, he's talking about an Old Testament principle at an end time period. And what he's showing us there is kings represent those that were business people, those that went out and took dominion. And then he's showing us priests were those that were in ministry full time and how they were the ones that spoke vision to those that were in marketplace ministry. And God is raising you up as no matter where you are, you have a story to tell. Guess what? You have a pulpit. Your pulpit may not be your church. Your pulpit, you may be an apostle of faith in the medical arena. You may be a prophet sitting there in a service department. You may be in a theater. Wherever you may be called, like they say, to the seven mountains.
God has to have someone there. I'll give you a good example. Michael Jackson had the sons of bishops who used to produce his music, but they were there, light shining in a dark place. How could we ever be effective if we're going to stay in the four walls when one of the prophecies that God gave the church, that the church would be in a place of habitations without walls? We have to break out of those restrictions and limitations so that we can expand the scope of the kingdom in places where it has never taken seat at.
That is awesome, Bishop. So therefore, instead of waiting for someone to call and, as some say, give you a platform, use the platform that you have. You use the platform that you have. Yes, sir.
Exactly, because there are many times we're waiting on people to build a stage for us when God has given us the power to build our own stage. And if you build your own stage, then your voice is deserving to stand on what you've constructed. Many times you are trying to step on a stage that you have not developed or you have not been equipped to step on. And sometimes you are moving ahead of time, and guess what? Your story is not ready for that particular platform. But because you have been led by the Spirit of God, for instance, Jesus said, look on the field, for they are ripe and they are ready, which means that there is an avenue that God has put you in. Your field might not be my field. When I was in the military, my field was logistics, where I had someone else that field was administration. Someone else was tactical. Someone else was infantry. But whatever our field was, guess what? It was ready to hear our voice. You got to find your field. And once you find your field, that is going to be your effective place. The world calls it finding your niche, finding your passion, finding your purpose. Because wherever you find your purpose, there will be your pursuit. And it wakes up your potential.
Thank you for that. So there's another nugget this morning for everybody. Find your field. Find your field. Work your spear. Work your spear this morning. Thank you so much for that encouragement. Now, another aspect of your ministry is you have your gifts have caused you to be sought after by diverse leaders from all different ethnic backgrounds. And you address religious, business, political, civic, and educational issues. Not too long ago, we were called. We received a call to go over to Brunswick to pray, not to protest. At the end of the Ahmaud Arbery trial, we were called not to protest, although there may have been some, but we were called to pray. And the day that the prayer went forth, it really, I was encouraged. I was thankful that very evening the defense rested their case. I believe had we gone any other way, the outcome may have gone differently. Now, as ministry leaders, as church leaders, as those of us, some who feel they don't need to get involved in issues like this, even as it relates to just gathering for prayer, tell us why being involved in issues, or do you believe that's important, to be involved in issues where injustice has caused lives to be taken prematurely? Tell us about that.
Well, I believe that God has raised us up to echo what is in his heart, and I believe that we as believers are called to declare, because sometimes the world don't understand the judgment, the justice, the mercy, and the grace of God. And sometimes they take things for granted, and they need to hear another voice that can bring equity or balance and unity in the midst of a community. And that is very important. It is very important for us as leaders to understand that we carry the weight of God in our lives. And many times God puts us in places because there are situations that need clarity. There are situations that need to bring the heart of God into a place that may be godless. And we've been called to do that. I remember I was called to Jamaica one time. They were in a situation where the prime minister was being ousted over something corrupted in the city. And we had the opportunity to pray over the parliament of Jamaica. And we prayed over the parliament of that Jamaica. And they said that the lady at that particular time was cheated out of her seat. But God gave me a prophecy that this situation shall be reversed and Esther shall rise in 3 years. And 3 years to the date as that prophecy went forward, she was elected and appointed as Prime Minister of Jamaica. And I believe that if we were not in that particular, if we did not have access to that assembly at that time, I believe that that word would have not been fulfilled. But because God put us in a place where we could speak what was in his heart, where he could put someone in that seat that understand the heart of their nation, then we saw God's mercy prevail.
Amen. Once again, thank you. That is powerful because the world needs to see, as we live in this world, we are have a what we call dual citizenship, and
yes,
we represent the kingdom. We represent Christ in everything that we do. And even riding down the road the other last Friday, as I was thinking about what we shared regarding the kingdom, you know, the law enforcement, if we're stopped, we're speeding, and we're driving down the road, we're speeding, and we get caught. You know, we are citizens of the kingdom, but if we get caught, or not just when we get caught, but speeding, breaking the law, that helps save lives. There's a speed limit because lives have been lost because people overextended the speed limit or drove over the speed limit. But as a citizen of the kingdom, even in that, if he stops us, how are we representing the one that we how does that look to the one we represent as a citizen of the kingdom? And so that came out better last week. But anyway, to God be the glory. as a student of the word, and I am a stickler for study. The Bible tells us study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You have gone to seminary. You are the president of Faith Life Christian University. So you have a PhD. You've gone and gotten all the education that is essential for effectiveness in leadership. And while some don't agree with seminary and don't believe that it's necessary, for me and for those who can, it adds discipline. It adds discipline to study. You've gone through school. You're president of a school. It must be important to you. Why? Tell us why Christian education is important to you.
Christian education is important because education always gives you an edge over the unlearned. And the scripture says, study to show thyself approved, a workman that need not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. You will find that some of your greatest leaders were doctors of the law. Paul himself, an apostle of faith, was a doctor. And he was groomed by other doctors because even when they tried to come against Paul, it was Dr. Gamaliel that stood up and said that this man has something that has never been revealed before. And if it's of God, it's going to stand. And so while you kicking against someone that God has nurtured, God has groomed, and God has raised up for such a time as this, education is important because it gives you an upper edge. It gives you education is like money. Education will defend you at critical times when you think you don't know what to do, but because you have took the time to go through a system that has shown you proven evidence that what you have took time to learn, whether it be from a basic place of learning a New Testament, Old Testament surveys. You've taken out the time now to understand from Genesis to Revelation, from theology to eschatology, or from the study of God to the study of end times. You understand the scope of what God was trying to say to you. And because you're educated now, it also puts you in a place where you are not treated as some common average person. It puts you in a place now, but there's a greater level of responsibility that's given to you, because much given, much is also required. And so education is great, but the greatest, Paul said, look, you know, I got the letter, but you know what? I have to also get the Spirit. So I can get education for my learning, but I still need the Spirit of God for my burning. So education is great because it develops my learning. But then when I tap into the realm of God, he puts a light on that learning and calls something to burn within me that I would. It is hard for me to explain it to you because it is what God has equipped me to do with every aspect of what he's called and trained me to do for such a time as this. And because you're equipped at that level, you can equip some people who may have, you know, think they don't have the competence, the sufficiency, or the adequateness in them to rise up into a place that they can be. It is having that ability to empower people who may be less fortunate than you to rise up and become something that they can't even see in themselves. You know, my teacher used to always say, son, you got to keep repeating it until it gets in your life, because the mother of all learning is the law of repetition. And I didn't understand that growing up, but at every stage in my life, I've understood that. And now I'm able to speak to people that are at the highest level in society as well as the lowest level in society. It has afforded me to speak to people in great levels of political arenas, as well as to the lowest commoner person in everyday society. It's giving me that leverage.
Thank you so much, Bishop. We're going to education, Bishop Anthony J. Hatcher, Ph.D. It always gives you an edge over the unlearned. And I thank you that you brought this out this morning, that there is a greater level of responsibility. We're going to talk about responsibility when we come back from our break, but we also still need the Spirit of God. We're thankful that the education helps us to gain information, but Holy Spirit enables us to get revelation on what we have studied and learned. And so we're going to take a quick break for station ID, ladies and gentlemen. And you said the law of all learning is the law of repetition. I always say repetition helps us to remember. We're thankful today and have an awesome, a wise, profound speaker, an awesome man of God joining us today, Bishop Anthony J. Hatcher, this morning from Rockledge, Florida. We're thankful today, and we are live at 5 this morning. Quick break for station ID. We are live at 5 this morning on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at Foxy, FOXY97.com. And you can join us on the conference call with these awesome men and women of God at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. For those that would like to listen again, this broadcast will be available on Spreaker.com and YouTube later on today. Bishop Anthony Hatcher this morning of Faith Life Outreach Christian Cathedral in Rockledge, Florida. So I want to talk about responsibility since you brought that out this morning. Yes, education, yes. Training, there's a great level to whom much is given, much is required. There is a great level of responsibility that comes with the learning. In leadership is all about responsibility. It's all about responsibility. Yes. And I believe that what Jesus is sharing with us in the Sermon on the Mount is to be responsible citizens of the kingdom.
Yes.
Is to be responsible citizens of the kingdom. As we've been talking about this the other day, one of the terms that we use for the Beatitudes are the attitudes to be about or basic kingdom attitudes, basic kingdom principles, the character traits that every citizen of the kingdom should demonstrate, with a promise, the blessing, the attribute, and then there's a promise that is connected to that. And as we get ready to go into our word this morning, we shared a little bit about the Beatitudes as we were doing our sound check. Talk to us a little bit this morning, or in the next few minutes this morning. We want to ask you to give us a word of encouragement. Whatever the Lord gives you to share this morning, we want to hear from Bishop Anthony Hatcher this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, for the next 20 or so minutes, Bishop Anthony Hatcher is going to minister to us. Receive him. Open your heart. Open your ears. Receive the word of the Lord this morning from the man of God, Bishop Anthony J. Hatcher. I want us to go in talking about responsibility. God bless you, Bishop. The broadcast.
Well, that is great, because I believe that there is a responsibility that God has given all of us as leaders, as servants, as sons of God, as those that are soldiers on the battlefield. No matter what level you are, you have responsibility. See, if I took away your ability, all you can do is respond to it. But if I give you responsibility, you have the power now to release what I have given you as a person to function in. When I was in the military, I was responsible for a certain level of people. Now, if that authority is taken back from me, I could still have those people around me, but those people would not be effective, because what has been given to me can be taken from me. I'm so glad that God, once he gives you authority, it is final, it is effective, and it is eternal. He said, look, he says, to as many as receive him, to them he gave them power, authority, to walk and to live as sons of God. Now, it is now our responsibility, it is our authority, our innate ability to function and live as what we have been called to do. Whether we transmit that by vision, we transmit that by our values, we transmit that by our vocation, we transmit that by showing people the victories that we have gained through our responsibility. And it is very important for you to know that every one of us is responsible, number one, to be a leader. We're responsible to be successful. We're responsible to have a sufficient or great lifestyle. God has given us the power to function in different areas in our walk with God. I'm excited this morning because Jesus is showing us his responsibility as God. He's showing us his responsibility as Lord. He's also showing us his responsibility when he comes down to create a culture, kingdom culture. He's showing us how he invests his life in a person that may be at the lowest place in their walk with God. And here he shows us his attribute. God shows us his character being invested in our condition. Because he tells us, number one, blessed are the poor. Now, you cannot get to the poor by understanding why he used the word blessed there. He used the word there, blessed. It is a function of empowerment. It is a function that God himself can exercise, that if God says you are blessed, guess what? It cannot be reversed. It cannot be canceled. It cannot be changed. He is now creating a commanded position for us in our low estate to rise up and walk in a place, even though we may be at a place that we don't even have the power to rise back up. But notice what he says, and I like this. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit. He could have said, blessed are the rich in spirit. Blessed are the great in spirit. Blessed are the wealthy in spirit. But here it is, God in his kingdom. God does not start at the high state of man. God starts at the lowest state of man. Let me tell you something. You may be at your lowest point in your life, but you're still blessed. You may be at the place in your life where you went through disappointment. You went through frustration. You went through things in your life, and you say, how can I rise? How can I get out of what God, how can I get out of what I'm facing? Now, he tells us over in the book of Isaiah, arise and shine, for thy light has come. In other words, he's saying, when you look at it in the original text, he's saying, arise out of your depression, arise out of your lowest condition, arise out of your lowest standard, arise out of your lowest state. Here Jesus is saying, blessed are you right in the condition that you're in, because whatever condition you are in, Lord have mercy, it is not permanent. It is temporary. And I'm here to tell somebody right now, as you're going along your day, you may feel like, you know what, I'm not in the place where I can see things complete in my life. But you got to understand, here is someone, amen, blessing you in your incompleteness, blessing you at a state in your life where you are inadequate, blessing you at a state in your life where you are insufficient. He still calls you blessed. So it does not matter where you are right now. You could be at the lowest point. You could be at a place in your life where you feel like you're not educated. You could be at a place in your life where you poorly function in certain aspects of your life, but God still calls you blessed. Why does he call you blessed? Because it shows you that you still have potential to rise up and become what God has called you to be. And notice what he said. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. See, if he raised up people that already had things, they would not know who they are in the kingdom of God. Why? Because they think they already own everything. They think they're already sufficient. But God comes down to your lowest point in your walk, in your experiences, in your encounters. And there's some people I'm talking to right now. You're at your lowest point, but God says you are a perfect candidate for the kingdom of heaven. You're a perfect candidate to advance the kingdom of God, heaven, and get everything that you need right now. So don't look at where you are. Look at where God's about to take you. He says, look, blessed. And I like this word blessed because it means to empower you to have a successful journey. Your journey may have started out a wreck. It may have started out broken into all kinds of pieces. But guess what God does? God takes those broken pieces and put them back together again. He says, look, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed is that person that may be at the lowest state in their life. They're candidates to walk in the kingdom of Almighty God. Isn't it amazing that God takes you like you are, but he never leaves you like you are? He never leaves you in a place where your pain, glory to God, tries to override your purpose. No, God will not allow your pain to continue to control your life. Your condition, glory to God, may feel like it's unfavorable. Your condition may feel like, God have mercy, is this where it's always going to be? Listen, you're not on this broadcast this morning by happenstance. You're on this broadcast because God is getting ready to break a cycle of your poor condition. He's getting ready to break a cycle of that low place. He's getting ready to bring you out of that valley of decision, that valley of the shadow of death, that valley of dryness. And God says, I don't care what state you're in. I'm calling you blessed. I'm calling you to have success. And notice what he says, blessed are they that mourn. And I'm going to tell you, I've seen a whole lot of people crying in this season. I've saw a whole lot of people bitter in this season. I've seen a whole lot of people suffering or aggravated over what they have lost, and they're going through some things where they feel like, man, it's not well with me. It's not sufficient with me. But God says, look at here, your tears are investments in your future. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. God saying, yes, you're in the morning, but you know God turns your morning into dancing. And I'm here to tell somebody, he says, blessed is the morn. Blessed blessed are those that mourn. They're going to be comforted. And I'm going to tell you something. I believe it's over there in 2 Corinthians 1. He talks about how God himself is the God of all comfort, that even while you are having a great child that's causing you to mourn, maybe you lost a loved one, maybe your best friend, glory to God, has departed and has caused a mourning to come over you. Well, I'm telling you something right now. The God of all comfort, while you're in your trial, while you're in your suffering, while you're in your moment of affliction, while you are mourning, and glory to God, because you don't have employment, you're mourning because your relationship is battered and it's on a rocky place. But I'm telling you, you're going to be comforted. The God of all comfort, my God, have mercy. You may feel like, I am not going to rise up today, but I'm telling you, weeping endured for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. And I'm here to tell somebody, why don't you just begin to wait till the daybreak? Why don't you begin to wait till the first light hits your day? I'm telling you, something unusual is going to happen for you. And I'm telling you, the Bible says, look, we gotta those that mourn, we got to get right in the circle with them and let them know, I cannot feel what you feel, but I can understand what you're feeling, and I can't get in your body and tell you that mourning is going to end right now. But what I can tell you, it's not going to last, because anything that's in this earth realm that you may be feeling right now is temporary. It's temporary. And you ought to give God a praise this morning that your mourning, that place where you've been mourning at, that place where you've been irritated at, where you've had this bitter in this in you, but God's going to turn that bitter into something better. God's going to turn, amen, that place of aggravation into a place of elevation, because he says, blessed are they that mourn. In other words, God says, you in a position where I can heal you. You in a position where I can restore you. You in a position where I can replenish you, where I can raise you up out of the confines of that place where you feel sad, where your feelings, glory to God, are bringing you to a point of wit's end. And it seems like you've lost your senses. You seem like you've lost your hope. Seem like you've lost, amen, this ability to look for something beyond what you feel, because your feelings seem to override all your faith. And you had a place in your life where you're saying, God, where are you? Why am I facing what I'm facing? Why am I having to do what I'm about to do? Let me share with you a principle. God may be voiceless in your dilemma, but he's victorious in your deliverance. He may be silent while you're in your situation, but I'm going to tell you something. He's going to sustain you while you're going to your critical moment. And God himself may not have to say one word to you. But I'm going to tell you one thing he does. He gives you strength, he gives you peace, and he gives you comfort. And so I want to tell you something today. Wait on the Lord and be of courage, because God, he's going to comfort your heart. He's going to strengthen your heart, and you're going to be able to endure through this very moment. And I know I'm running out of time here, so let me do my best to try to hit one more of these beatitudes, and that is, blessed are the meek, 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 blessed are those that have a gentle heart, blessed are those, amen, that are humble. Let me tell you something, just because you're meek, it don't mean that you're weak, it doesn't mean that you are inadequate, it doesn't mean that you're not strong enough to handle where you're going. No, meekness is showing that you honor, you have humility, that you respect God, that you're willing to condescend out of your willingness, out of your ways, out of your workings, and you are able to submit to God so that God's perfect plan and will can operate in your life. You see, he gives grace to the humble. He gives grace. There's a certain kind of favor that comes on you when you humble yourself. There's certain kind of privileges that is extended on the meek. There's certain kind of benefits that is extended on a person that knows how to step out of their identity and step into the plan and step into that which God has given them insight to perform. And many times people are attacking you. Because I can tell you that there are certain areas in my life where people will be attacking my character, and God will say, son, humbleness is still the way. Don't worry about what they're doing to you. Don't worry how they're labeling you. Don't matter what they're calling you. They may be calling you a dysfunction. They may be calling you a derelict. But you keep on. Keep that meek spirit. Keep that humble spirit. Keep that spirit that is not trying to be recognized, that's not trying to get the spotlight shined on them. Because I'm going to tell you something. The Bible says this. It says that when you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, I'm telling you, your due time is going to come. And I'm here to tell this audience right now. Some of you waited and you thought your due time wasn't going to come. Some of you are at this point in your life where, God, I'm at the end of this year and I don't see anything happen. Notice what the meek inherits the earth. They possess anything in this realm that they have been waiting on God to do in their life. Because they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They're going to mount up. They're going to move to a higher level. They're going to move to their next season. They're going to move to that next door that's opening for them. They're going to walk and not be weary, walk, run and not faint. Guess what? But it starts from a place of meekness, and meekness is not a sign that you are weak. Meekness is a sign that you're going to sit there and be patient and allow God to work out some things that you can't work out yourself. You're just going to submit yourself under God, resist the devil, and he will flee. But you're going to draw nigh to God, because you know soon, very soon, God's going to draw nigh to you. And the old songwriter used to say, he might not come when you want him. But I'm telling you, somebody today, stay meek before God. Stay in that right frame of mind. Stay in that right focus. Because I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes you have to be sober in your focus. Because sometimes when you are being attacked, you're being assaulted, the enemy will try to intoxicate your mind with the wrong influence, with the wrong thing, and he'll make you aimless. But as long as you're meek, as long as you humble yourself, God will bring you to your due time. And I'm here to tell somebody today under the sound of my voice, he says you're still blessed. He says you're still going to have success. You may feel like, man, I'm submitting to some people that don't understand where I'm going. Stay meek. I'm submitting to some people that's ostracizing me, criticizing me, penalizing me, and they're setting me aside. But I'm telling you something. You have a new height. You have a new depth. There's a new width that God's going to stretch you out in, and you're going to be able to be sustained in a critical moment in your life, because he says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I'm telling you, you're going to possess what you have been longing to see God do in your life. What is your confirmation? Your confirmation today is to let you know you have an inheritance. Your confirmation today is to let you know that whatever God has promised you, he's going to bring it to pass for you in your life today. Here's this fourth one, and it says this, blessed are those, and I just love this, blessed are those that hunger and thirst for righteousness. Now, they could be hunger and thirsting for world acclaim. They could be hunger and thirsting for popularity. They could be hunger and thirsting for worldly status. They could be hunger and thirsting for success in their life. But he said, blessed are they that hunger and thirst for what? Righteousness. The word righteous there is talking about a person that wants to be in right standing, that wants to be in the right place, that wants to be under the right privilege. And here God says, look, he who knew no sin became sin, that you and I could become the righteousness of God. And I'm here to tell you, he says, those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, those that hunger and thirst to always be in the right place. Because Jesus said like this, he said, I always do those things that please God. In other words, Jesus said, I'm always in the right place so that God could be honored, so that God could be glorified. And I'm here to tell you right now, you may feel like you're out of place, but there is a kingdom alignment bringing you back to the place where you ought to be. How are you going to get in that place? You got to improve your character. If you want to be aligned, God's going to break you out of some habits. He's going to break you out of some things that are stopping you from understanding the righteousness of God in your life. When you hunger and thirst for righteousness, the greatest thing that God does is he moves past shame away from you. He moves guilt away from your life. He moves fear away from your life. Because when the blood of Jesus comes on you, he declares you righteous in the sight of Almighty God. Don't ever lose your desire. Because, you see, he says, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. When you have a desire, it simply means you can visualize with a mental picture what you want to be filled with, what you crave for, what you long for, what you desire for God to do. David said, look, I'm thirsty for you, God. I'm as a man in a dry place. I want you to fill me up, and I want to experience your glory as I saw it in the sanctuary. And I'm here to tell somebody, why are you going on your workplace today? Why you're starting your day out? Why are you commanding your morning today? Why don't you command God to fill those empty places in your life so that you can come in that right place, where you can come in that right position, so the enemy can't bring the guilt of yesterday, bring the shame of yesterday. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And I want to share that with somebody today. And I want to thank you all for giving me this privilege to come on this broadcast. Remember, God's attributes right now is empowering you. No matter what condition you're in, God is showing you that the power of the King is getting ready to change your condition, and it will not be temporary when it happens. It will be permanent. Rise up today and say, I'm blessed no matter what state I'm in, no matter what I'm going through in my life. I'm stepping out enjoying the blessing that comes from the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who was, which is, and that which is to come. He's the author. He's the finisher of my faith. And so today I'm going to embrace what God has declared over me, and I know as of today, I will never be the same. Thank you, Dr. Sellers, for giving me this opportunity to come on live at 5 today.
Thank you, sir, for sharing, Bishop Anthony Hatcher. Thank you for sharing. And ladies and gentlemen, there is a place for you in the kingdom. There is a place for you in the kingdom, but it starts with receiving the King of Kings into your heart. It starts with receiving Jesus into your heart. It starts with repentance. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You gain access to the kingdom through repentance, through receiving Jesus as Lord. So repent. Repeat these words with me this morning. If you desire to all those things that Bishop talked about this morning are yours when you say yes, oh God, to Jesus as Lord of your life. So repeat after me. Father, it is written in your word that if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in my heart that you've raised him from the dead, I shall be saved. Therefore, Father, I confess that Jesus is my Lord. I make him Lord of my life right now today. I renounce my past life with Satan and close the door to all of his devices. I thank you today for forgiving me of all my sins. Jesus is my Lord, and I thank you that I have a place in his kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. We've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God. We're thankful today, Father. We're thankful for you for providing this opportunity for us to hear your word, receive your word, and begin to live according to your word. They that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Meekness is not weakness, but strength under control. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus for this time and this hour. We give you praise today. Somebody shout in Jesus' name. Somebody give God praise this morning. There's a lot of people on the call. Give God praise and thank the Lord. Lord, for what you have heard today. You are blessed. You are blessed this morning. You are spiritually prosperous. You fully satisfied today as a kingdom of the citizen, a citizen of the kingdom, rather. Somebody say, I am blessed today. And we thank God for this word that we have heard. Weeping may endure for a night. Somebody ought to shout, it's temporary. So thank you so much, Bishop Hatcher. We're going to go out with a bang this morning. We're going to go out with Jeffrey Golden, glory to the Lamb. And if you can stay on, Bishop Hatcher, I know you have your broadcast at 6:30. If you can stay on for just a few more minutes, I believe we want to hear from the people that are on the call. Thank you so much to our Apostle Terry Wings from Tampa, Florida, for coming in and joining us this morning. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for taking the time to wake up with us live at 5. We got about 30 seconds. If you want to just say hello to everybody, God bless you. God bless you, and God keep you well. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for joining us, Apostle Williams. Thank you, everybody that joined us this morning. To God be the glory. Jeffrey Golden, glory to the Lamb. Those on the call, please remain on the line.
To the Lamb, glory to the Lamb, everybody say,
glory to the Lamb.
We sing,
glory to the Lamb.
We give all
glory
to the Lamb.
Yes.
We sing,
glory,
glory to the Lamb.
To the Lamb.
This is why. For he is
Alpha
and Omega, forever is he, and he will reign
forever.
Holy, 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 holy is he. So together let's sing glory to the Lamb. Father, we sing tonight, glory,
glory,
glory to the Lamb. We give all the glory
to the Lamb.
Jesus is his name. We give
glory,
glory to the Lamb. For he is, he's the beginning, and he is. And he will reign forever with us. sovereign one, we give glory to the Lord. The Almighty One, we give glory.
Glory to the Lamb.
Great and marvelous are your deeds. Just and true are your words, Lord God Almighty. Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? You alone are holy, and all nations will come and worship before you. Saints and angels sing. The saints and angels sing. Glory to the Lamb. We sing
glory
to the Lamb. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. One more time. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
And friends, for the last hour, you have been listening to Command Your Morning Prayer Line. Live this morning from Near Prune Ministries, Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, out of Waycross, Georgia, where the pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III. The hosts of Command Your Mornings now, Monday through Friday, is Evangelist Dr. Renee Sellers. Don't forget to listen online at www.foxy97.com. Command Your Morning is a service of the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, Waycross, Georgia.